Flip-flops are a digital electronic circuit which can be used to store information. This is the basis of registers, which are a fundamental part of microprocessors and computers. This will explain about sequential logic, that is, electronic circuits where the output is based on the sequence that data arrives at the circuit. At the end of this video, it'll show how flip-flops are used to create a storage register such as those you may see inside a microprocessor. This will then be useful from a practical point of view for digital makers who may be interested in understanding how a shift register works. The circuit shown is an adder circuit, which is a combinational logic circuit. This means that the output of the circuit can always be determined based upon just the inputs. I've already explained about logic gates and combinational logic circuits in my earlier videos. Please check the description for links to those videos. Sequential logic is about maintaining a state. The output of the circuits is not just based on the status of the inputs, but on what has happened before, and often based on a clock signal. This is an essential part of a programmable computer in that information is held in the computer so that it's possible to process multiple sources of information or determine the next course of action. The diagram shown is a basic flip-flop based on two NOR gates. This is a simple flip-flop. There are better ones that are normally used, but this is helpful to show how this works. There are two inputs labelled as set and reset. There are then two outputs, Q and Q prime, which are complementary outputs. That is to say that when one is high, the other is low, and vice versa. In this case, I've shown a single quote mark next to the second output, which is referred to as Q prime, meaning not Q. Often this is replaced with a line above Q, which is known as a bar, which would be known as Q bar. You will see an example of that later in the video. When power is initially provided to the logic gates, and if the inputs are both at zero, it is not possible to determine what state the flip-flops will be in, and so what the output will be. To demonstrate this, we can start by sending a high signal to either the set or reset. In this case, I'll show the set. With the set at 1 and reset at 0, then the bottom NOR gate will always give a 0 output. This sets Q prime to 0. It also puts a 0 to the top NOR gate. The top NOR gate then gives a 1 output. So, when the set is taken high, then the Q output is set high and Q prime is low. Now, if set goes to 0, there is still a 1 input to the bottom NOR gate from the Q output. Therefore, the condition doesn't change. So the flip-flop remembers that output. Now, if reset is taken high instead, then the top NOR gate has a 1 input, so its output changes to 0, setting Q to 0. The bottom NOR gate now has both inputs to 0, so its output changes to 1, also setting the second input to the top NOR gate to 1. So Q is set to 0 and Q prime set to 1. Now, changing the reset back to a 0, then the other input to the top NOR gate comes from Q prime, and the NOR gate keeps that state. So after reset, it maintains its state with Q at 0. This is essentially how a basic flip-flop works. There is a problem with this flip-flop though, if set and reset are both set to 1. If you set both the inputs to 1, then the outputs Q and Q prime are both 0, which is an invalid state. There are other limitations or issues with this flip-flop, but it's useful to understand this simple flip-flop as it gives us a good idea of how they work. The real limitation with a basic flip-flop isn't so much about that invalid state, as you can prevent that through hardware. But the problem is about timing. Timing is an important feature in sequential digital circuits, and in particular when they are used in microprocessors, as you need to ensure that the inputs from the previous stage are valid before you can use them. This gives rise to different types of set-reset flip-flops, or as I've abbreviated them here, SR flip-flops. They do involve more complicated circuits, but I've shown them here just using a block symbol, as you're unlikely to want to create them yourself using basic logic gates. The one shown on the left has an extra input marked as E, which refers to enable. The set and reset inputs are only used when the enable is high. The enable pin can be set high permanently, in which case it will operate the same as the basic flip-flop earlier. When using precision timing, then you normally want to look at a particular clock edge. In the case of the symbol on the middle, there's a triangle to indicate that the center input is a positive edge triggered clock input. So the output will only change when that pin goes from low to a high signal. The right symbol is the same, but with a circle in front indicating that this is negative edge triggered. As with the basic flip-flops, there should not normally be an instance where S and R are both high on the same clock signal. However, this is normally handled properly. In the case of the SR flip-flop, the set is usually dominant, or an RS flip-flop is the same, but where both are 1, then the reset is dominant. The SR flip-flop is a very useful circuit. There is another kind which is at least as useful, which is the D flip-flop. The D refers to data, and it is constructed such that whatever data is on that pin, either a 1 or 0, becomes the output Q when the appropriate clock signal is received. If you think about it logically, you may be able to think about a way to create the D flip-flop using an SR flip-flop, and one more simple logic gate. Pause the video here and have a think. Did you work it out? It's a NOT gate. The D flip-flop is basically an SR flip-flop with a D input used as S, and the opposite of D, so D connected through a NOT gate, as the R input. This gets rid of the invalid state where S and R are both 1, as that is not allowed. The real benefit of this is that the D input can be connected to a data line inside a processor, or using the output from a logic gate, and it will store that information. This is sometimes called a latch. If you drop the Q prime or Q bar output and duplicate this circuit 8 times, then you'll get an 8-bit storage register or an 8-bit latch. This diagram shows an 8-bit register with a single clock. This would be combined into a single integrated circuit, or in the case of a processor, as one of the many internal memory registers. In the event of a processor, it would read and write data onto a bus. A bus is a collection of bidirectional data lines. In the event of an 8-bit processor, then that is 8 data lines. When connected to a bus, the input and output would be combined together as they connect to the same bus, with an enable for the clock, so it only loads data when the input enable is triggered and a clock signal received, and enable on the output, so that it only puts information onto the bus when the data needs to be sent to the bus. When the output is not enabled, then it gives a high impedance output, effectively an open switch for each output, so that it does not interfere with the bus. You can sometimes see this on integrated data sheets as a tri-state output. This video has shown an example of how sequential logic circuits can be used to create state or as a form of memory. This can be purchased as integrated circuits, or you will commonly see them as an output stage for other circuits, such as the adder in the previous video, and as an extra stage in a shift register in the next part of this video series. This has just been the theory so far, but the next video in this series will show a practical application of sequential logic in the form of a shift register, which will form part of a 7-segment LED display. If you found this useful, you may also like my book, Learn Electronics with Raspberry Pi by Stuart Watkiss, published by Apress. If these videos are popular, then I'll look at adding some more videos on digital electronics in the future. So please subscribe to my channel to get notified of new videos. And if there is something you'd like me to cover on future videos, either on digital electronics or any other digital maker topic, please let me know in the comments.